Fiber composite cellular structures have the potential to change the way we are doing lightweight engineering. Today I will talk about the latest achievement in this respect using 3D printing. My name is Franz Rimmelmoser. I am a material scientist. Together with Lisa Marie Faller, I am heading the research group at Meyer at Carinthia University of Applied Sciences. My co-workers are named below and will be introduced later. The presentation is parted in four main sections as follows: why continuous fiber composites printing, state of the art, let's get started, and current developments. A remarkable example in nature is the mammoth tree. It grows to a height of more than 100 meters. This is possible because the tree produces cellular structures as shown on the right, thus allowing giant growth without collapse by its own weight. This slide shows the great advantage of composite materials over ordinary polymers using the material property chart. In the chart, the best material would be at low densities and at high stiffness, and therefore on the top left, shown here as optimum material. As you can see, there's no material in this range, but the closer a material is to the optimum material, the better it is. The chart shows that the conventional polymer cellular structures are much farther away than fiber reinforced cellular structures. The difference is 2 orders of magnitude. That means a cellular structure made of fiber materials has only about 1% of the weight for the same stiffness compared to the same structure made of polymers. If not only stiffness is important, but also strength and toughness, we need to go to continuous fibers on the right side of the chart instead of short or long fibers, which are shown on the left and in the middle of the chart. Thus, the road to heaven for material scientists seems clear. Just print cellular structures with continuous fiber composites. But the thing is not that clear at all. The main challenge is that fibers must be oriented in the principal stress direction in order to get the best from it. This is quite easy to achieve for simple structures like tensile or painting bars. Even rotation for force vectors in the plane can be dealt with laminate structures. This is well known from traditional composite manufacturing as shown in the left figure. However, the situation is much more complicated for shear and torsion loading or even for complex stress states. In such a case, the fibers must be oriented in space as indicated in the right figure. Most of the research done in 3D printing of continuous fiber composites unfortunately is only for simple stress state. The companies and researchers use three-axis gantry robots for structures smaller than 1 meter, as shown here on the left side of the chart, and industrial robots for structures larger than 1 meter, as shown here on the right side of the chart. Maybe the best known companies are Markforged and Anisoprint, but there are also others like Continuous Composites and 9D Labs. The print head used by these companies differs in detail, but in principle they are all the same. In all variants, a filament or fiber bundle is applied to the printed part through a nozzle. The bond is achieved by a thermoplastic material that coats the fibers of fiber bundles. A specific temperature and pressure curve causes the material to consolidate, resulting in a compact composite. The rest of the presentation will focus on our own developments in 3D printing of fiber composites. For now, let me summarize what we have learned from the previous discussions. First, the fibers must be placed along the main stress direction. Second, it needs its own printhead technology. Third, for small and medium-sized parts, gantry robots are mostly used. For larger parts, industrial robots are used. Fourth, there's a research in various research groups on the subject of 3D printing of fiber composites, but mostly for simple geometries and simple load paths. There's no ready solution on the market for complex parts or complex load paths. If you want to get further, you have to develop a process yourself. We have done that. I would like to discuss the concept and present the first results here. First, we had to select a suitable market for products made of 3D printed fiber composites. This was done by Lisa Marie Faller and she decided to go for medical assistive devices such as prostheses. Why is that? First, there are about 30 million people worldwide with needs for medical assistive devices. Second, the global market volume in the 3D printing sector for medical technologies is estimated at 5.6 billion euros for 2030, and therefore it is quite a large market. Second, we had to develop the process for 3D printing of continuous fiber composites. The process now consists of 6 steps as follows. First, material development. Second, development of a design method for the new materials. Then development of an algorithm for print path optimization. Fourth, development of the hardware, means the print head. Fifth, development of the whole pilot line for printing the demonstrator and developing the demonstrator. The following slides, these 6 steps are discussed in more detail. The materials you use strongly influence the properties of the final demonstrator. We mostly used filaments of the company Markforged, but we also tested biofiber materials. Important are the filament diameter as well as the fiber volume content. The characterization of the materials was done by Rosemarie Heim. Her work is already published. For designing products with the new material, we selected a method that is inspired by dragonflies. As you can see, the wings of the dragonflies are made of lattice structures with several types of nodes. There are fixed nodes that allow force transmission, flexible nodes that allow rotation in the node, and the type of node that allows rotation about rod axis, similar to a window hinge. It has been shown that the arrangement in the dragonfly wing results in particular stable, robust, at the same time flexible wing structure. In our research group, Clarissa Becker has started the topology optimization, taking into account material scatter. She has her own presentation at this conference. If anyone is interested in more details, please join her presentation. The next point to be made is the development of an algorithm for selecting the print path. For a two-dimensional structure, the results is shown on the figure on the left. It is important that the fibers are not cut nor bent in the main load paths. The result of the print path is translated to a G-code for the multi-axis printer with Rhino. This work is done by Khaled Ibrahim. Printing the continuous fiber composites, a special print head is needed. Hannes Oberlercher developed such a print head. He has shown that next to the nozzle we also need a consolidation unit for getting a compact and void-free microstructure. He also presents his work on that conference, and if you are interested, you may join his presentation. For the multi-axis printing, we started with a pilot line of the company 5-axis Maker. However, in the meanwhile, we decided to develop our own multi-axis printer in order to produce prototypes with industry standards. We are already successful with a 4-axis printer, and now we start with developing a 5-axis printer. This project is driven by Marius Laux. Finally, you see here a demonstrator with a tube structure that we have printed in 3D with inclined fiber angles. Alexander Berndt gives a presentation at this conference to the behavior of these tubes during impact loading. Again, if you are interested, please join his presentation. The team working on this topic consists of 15 researchers, as can be seen on this slide, with different competencies from the fields of mechanical engineering, robotics, sensor technology and material science. I would like to express my sincere thanks to all the collaborators who have contributed to making 3D printing of continuous fiber composites possible, even for complex geometries and load paths. Finally, let me thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, please feel free to contact me. Please email me at the address provided on the slide. Thank you again.